So, I wrote this poem yesterday. It's called Depression of the Nondepressed, and I essentially wrote it as I consistently find myself surrounded by people who I love and care about who have and struggle with depression. So, this is what I wrote about it. His smile is as big as the superior shore and as radiant as sun gleaming off the water on a mid-July afternoon. His hands wave to me as if I'm a childhood friend, one that ran down that coastline picking up copper-glistened stones and shards of wave-sanded glass, only to put them in a jar which perched atop a bookshelf labeled with his name on it. His eyes told me another story, though, and the summer afternoons were long gone when I saw the turbulent storms that destroyed his ship, his soul, years ago. His palms told me a different tale when I noticed the amount of scars on them from a futile attempt of holding together his tiny fishing boat. Where was Jesus to say, "Peace, be still," to those waters? I remember the way her laugh sounded like wind chimes rustling in the light breeze of spring. The echoes can be heard all the way back to the unfinished basement of when I was four, to the newly stained deck of every summer. Her cuts did not let memories into her system more easily. Her tears did not cleanse her system free of the toxins that the world put into her years ago via sense of a newly stained deck or dust of the unfinished basement floor. I took her raised white scars and musical vocal cords and put them in a book on the same shelf as the jar and labeled it with her name. His glasses provided me windows to the windows of his soul. Apparently, glasses magnify and help one see, but I was only barricaded more, and his windows were frosted over from years of exposure to harsh Minnesota winters. His arms may be warm when I am embraced, but his fingertips tell me that he has had frostbite for far too long, probably needing to cut them off. It is said that if your right eye causes you to stumble, it is better to take it out and be blind on that side, so maybe I should ask him for another set of morphine pills so I can cut off those purple fingertips, which bring him closer and closer to carrying out any suicidal tendencies he has ever had. All the while, I am whispering loving words which only lead to more emptiness in his heart. What a great addition to my collection will his fingernails be, with a pristine white label and Sharpie name right below his spot on my shelf. I can see her long brown hair flowing behind her as I attempt to catch up to her across the gym. God gifted Samson with strength through his long hair, so why is it that I only see broken bones in her legs and bruises across her heart? I've never seen knees bend in that direction before, nor have I ever been so entranced by the 80s-esque tie-dye every beat in her heart produces. If she cannot run to God, how will she ever get to heaven one day? But I promise to reserve her a spot on my bookshelf. With golden freckles glued to her face like glitter, I hope that I can catch a few extras to put in her spot. You see, this is what it looks like from the outside peering in. This is what it looks like to watch depression happen and not be able to do anything about it. Depression reduces the people in my life to dead nails, irreparable glass, distant laughs, and memories that can only be recorded on paper, while I am hoping that I will remember it all because my butterfly net broke long ago when I tried to catch her open wounds fluttering through the air. And now all anyone can ever receive from me is love sifted through a multitude of people in pieces as big as grains of sand and copper stones from the superior shore. I may collect stories and pieces of hearts offered to me, but I am incapable of fixing anything because how does someone broken have enough authority to rebuild another broken being? I do not have tools, I do not have grout or tape or glue. I have gauze, and it's all I have to offer, which doesn't seem like much, but I am constantly praying that my love will eventually be enough.